L'altra cara de la lluna, amb Nando Caballero.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
Fellow Americans.
He's been sick. And I think his wife is gonna bring him some chicken soup.
Déu-n'hi-do, el Plastic People, el senyor Fran Zappa, aquí a l'altra cara de la lluna, dintre del seu segon disc, el segon llarga durada, 1968, amb això de Zappa. Per començar, la Pauline Butcher. Pauline, hola, què tal?
Hello. Thank you for
Pauline és l'autora d'un llibre que es diu Alucina, mi vida con Fran Zappa.
Yeah, Nando was saying that he specifically chose Plastic People because it is one of the very first tunes that you talk about in the book.
Because it was the reason I was there, to take down the lyrics of Absolutely Free. And of course I was taken aback because at the time most of the lyrics were Love Me Do or Let's Spend the Night Together. And here he was with lyrics like Plastic People and Call Any Vegetable, or Brown Shoes Don't Make It. And so I'm trying to take down these lyrics, and I had to make some of them up because I couldn't understand them. They were incomprehensible to me. And when he read them back, he laughed and said, oh God, these are so funny, you should write your own. And I said to him, well, if I did, I would make them less rude. And he debated that with me for about half an hour, and I was very impressed with that because anybody else in 1967 would have shown me the door, let alone talk to a secretary about his songs and whether they were good or bad. And he spent a whole half an hour discussing with me the rights and wrongs of Brown Shoes Don't Make It, which, as you know, what the lyrics are, they're pretty outrageous, even today, I think. Of a young girl of 13 years old making love to a middle-aged man on the White House lawn and covering her up with syrup and strapping her on again. I think it's pretty outrageous. And then later on the lyrics go on, how would you do it, Daddy, or something. I forget what they are. Then, you know, I thought they were pretty outrageous, but he took it in a very gentlemanly way, and he spoke in his quiet voice the way he always did, and honored what I had to say and engaged with it. It was incredible. Between that first encounter and the time several months later when he offered me the job, there were three other encounters with him. I saw him again. He appeared at the Albert Hall, and we had quite a pleasant chat then. He was very gentlemanly, and I waved him off on his tour of Europe, his very first tour in 1967. Then he was living in New York, and I went to see him in New York and met his wife, Gail. And I went on to my sister's and then came back into New York on my way home. And he invited me to his flat, and Gail wasn't there. So I was alone in the flat with Frank Zappa. And that was a bit of an encounter because he did choose the opportunity to hit on me. And I thought to myself, well, it's 1 o'clock in the morning. I'm in this apartment. Is it my fault? Did I give him the wrong impression? And he'd already offered me the job in the restaurant when we went for dinner first. And I thought this was a condition of the job, and I was really undecided as to what to do about it because I wanted this job in Hollywood, for God's sake. And now here I was being compromised, and I sort of waffled out an answer of, well, I don't think it's right, you know, or something like that. And he actually agreed with me.
Aquest és un dels, també dels...
I do recommend when people ask me about Frank Zappa, I always recommend that they read a general biography first to get an overview of his life in all. But then my book is the only one that actually gets inside the home life of him and how he was with his family and with the Mothers of Invention, because none of the other books have that personal view. It's also the only book that gives any information about Gail, And that's quite important now, since she herself died recently, and nobody has any idea what she was like. And this is quite revealing, I think, about her.
Això queda molt palès després de la mort de Frank, com va portar.
I don't think anyone at the time appreciated quite how effective she was in dealing with Frank and his life. They had their ups and downs in their marriage. Certainly in the middle years, it came close to breaking up, but she always hung in there, and he came in the end to appreciate her completely for her role in it. He always said that he didn't do love, right? But in his own book, he says very clearly, "I met Gail and I fell in love," which was extraordinary for him to say, because he'd spent all those years with me telling me that it was rubbish to fall in love with anyone. So there he was saying it in his book. So, yeah, she played a very important role. And I think that in my book, I reveal her as a human being quite well.
Pels zapiadictos, com es digui, pels fans, hi han uns moments d'aquests d'enveja total.
I have to revert to my letters to remind myself exactly that feeling. But I would sit on the two steps outside my room, which went straight onto the living room, and it was a huge room, and I would be about 50 feet away, and he would not like you normally to be listening to him or watching him, but I was far enough away for him not to be affected, and he knew I was there and knew I was appreciated. And sometimes I would be moved almost to tears, because he would make some really beautiful sounds come out of the piano. The main problem I had with it, when he later went into the studio, he would distort those sounds quite a lot, and I was disappointed with that quite often, that those beautiful sounds, the one for Grace Slick, "Give Me a Snack" or something like that. And it was a beautiful piece of music he wrote at the piano. And we went into the studio that night, and then he put all these, you know, snorts and bumps on it and noises, and it seemed to me it ruined it, really. But I was privileged, there's no question about that. When he played at the piano, he played with one finger, occasionally a chord, but mostly with one finger playing out the tune. And he would write it down, then he'd do the other hand and write it down. And then Ian Underwood would come along and play the piece with both hands.
Tocava una mà només, no?
And he would sit there and he'd turn the pages for him, and he'd be, you know, in reverie.
Una de les cançons que més li agraden de Zappa.
We're going to listen to some music now. He would love you to choose one of Frank's tracks. What did you particularly like?
Well, I particularly like "Watermelon in Easter Hay." It's beautiful. I mean, if anyone doesn't know about Frank Zappa and they hear that, it might actually make them think, well, that's fantastic, you know.
Doncs estem aquí a l'altra cara de la lluna escoltant el Frank Zappa i parlant amb la Pauline Butcher, que ha editat, que ha escrit.
I always wanted to be a writer, and I started off trying to write a play for BBC Radio 4, and the producer told me the only way to break in is to write something that no one else can write, and the only story no one else could write is my experiences with Frank Zappa. Now, the reason it took so long is because I didn't follow up on my ambition to be a writer until my son went to university. So I started as a radio play, and to cut a long story short, it didn't happen. And so I, so mad, I wrote to all the publishers, and 12 wrote back and said, send me the chapters. And I knew I had a product that I could sell. One of the things that some fans are disappointed when they read the book is that they think Frank, because he was so magnificent with his music and his intellect, that somehow as a person he ought to also be magnificent. And my book shows him to be quite an ordinary sort of person. And it brings him down to size a little bit, and some fans don't like that.
Molt bé, doncs, Pauline, Julián, moltíssimes gràcies per venir aquí a l'altra cara de la lluna i per presentar-nos aquest llibre.
Thank you very much for coming and for presenting the book and for writing it.
L'altra cara de la lluna, amb Nando Caballero.